Hi everyone, welcome to Unacademy CAT for MBA. Good evening everyone. I hope all of you are doing well. This is our fifth session of vocabulary, and in this session we are going to talk about analogies.
Hi everyone, welcome to Unacademy.
Okay, so before we start the session, let me quickly introduce myself. My name is Apurva Deshpande. I have completed my master's in English. I have been teaching English for over 7 years now, and I've also qualified some exams conducted by the University of Cambridge. As I said, we are going to talk about analogies today, and so I'll also tell you how to, you know, get the maximum score in these questions. Basically, what are the steps that we need to do so that we can answer these questions correctly, okay? And then what type of questions can we expect in this section? First of all, we can expect around 2 to 3 questions of analogies in exams like SNAP, NMAT, okay, ZAT, etc. All right, so please subscribe our YouTube channel at Unacademy CAT for MBA, and I'm sure all of you are also on Telegram and you're following us at CAT for MBA so that you get material on the sessions that you've been attending. So if you have not subscribed to our channel yet, please subscribe to our YouTube channel right now at Unacademy CAT for MBA. Okay, we've been talking about this, everyone. So, you know, there are about 4 to 5 months remaining for your entrance tests now. And this period is absolutely crucial and something that will definitely help you and, you know, achieve your dream score in these exams is if you take up the Unacademy subscription. Okay, so you can go for the 1 year plan, or you can also go for the 2 year plan. So the 1 year plan will come at 15,750 rupees and the 2 year plan will come at 18,900 rupees. Okay, so just think of this amount for 2 years. It's already a very reasonable deal. Plus, if you use this code, this is my code, everyone, APURBA. So if you use this code, you will get a further 10% off. All right, so please subscribe to Unacademy. Right, let's begin with the session today. So as I said, we are going to talk about analogies. Now, what are these and then how to solve these questions? So basically what we need to remember is when you get a question of this type, you are given a pair of words usually. Okay, and then you need to guess what should be the next pair of words. Sometimes you need to guess what should be the next pair of words, or, you know, a single word like fill in the blank, or sometimes you also need to identify the relationship which is there in the words. Okay, so the first step in solving these questions is understanding the original relationship that is given to you. Okay, so take a look at the first pair that is given to you very carefully, and then just check how are those two words related. Okay, whether they are synonyms, whether they are antonyms, whether, you know, there's just a difference of a part of speech. So one is a noun and one is an adjective. Okay, so first step is going to be that we'll read the first pair very carefully and we'll try to understand what logical relationship do those words have. Okay, once you've identified the relationship, then we are going to find the same relationship in the next pair of words that is given to us. Okay, so basically once you've done this step, you know what you're looking for. Okay, so after that our task becomes quite easy. Now, the second very crucial thing that we need to remember, everyone, is, and you know, this step is something that students often miss and get the answers incorrect. So always remember this. You need to follow the same sequence as the pair of words that is given to you. Okay, so for example, if it is, let's say, noun and adjective. Okay, if that is the relationship given to you, so you need to have the same relationship in the next, you know, in the answer option that you select. It can't be adjective and noun. Got it? So first of all, the relationship has to be the same. And second thing that we need to remember is that the sequence has to be the same. All right. Now, when we are talking about these relationships, okay, what kind of questions can we expect? What kind of relationships can we expect? So take a look. Okay, so when we have these questions, sometimes there could be questions related to synonyms or antonyms. We have already dealt with these, everyone. So if you've not watched these videos, please take a look at the previous videos on the channels, you will get to learn a lot of new words. Okay, then there could be different parts of speech, you know, that could be the relationship like a noun and a verb, or you know, a pair like this. Advice and advice. Do you remember how these words are related, everyone? This is something that we talked about when we talked about, you know, words that you get often confused with. So again, if you've not watched that video, take a quick look at that video also after this session, of course. Okay, so with the spelling that has C is the noun and this one is the verb. Okay, so that is the relationship. So something like this can also be given to you. Then it could also be a relationship where one word is the worker or, you know, the professional, and the other word is related to a tool or an equipment that this person uses in their job. Okay, so a simple example like surgeon and scalpel. Now surgeon is the worker, professional, and scalpel is a surgical knife. So scalpel is something that the surgeon uses. Okay, or worker and his job. So same, using the same example, I can also say surgeon and surgery. So something that this person does, or his workplace. So a surgeon and a hospital. Okay, something like this. And then you will have to figure out the next relationship, the next pair of words. Okay, all right. So another kind of relationship that we can expect in these questions is an object and its function, okay, or action. What does the object do? So for example, wheel revolves. So a wheel revolves, okay, something like that. Or an object, and what does that object represent? So when you say red, love. So red is a color, or white, peace, okay. So white is a color that represents peace. So something like that can also be asked. Then a word and its meaning or its usage in a sentence, okay, or its function. How does it function in a sentence? That can also be asked. Then there could be questions, you know, based on gender. So for example, a particular word that suggests like female and male, that could be asked. And then this is also a very common relationship that is asked everyone, which is a part and whole. You know, a part of something and the word that describes the whole of something. So we are going to have mostly all these types of relationships in the sessions, the session that we are going to take a look at. Okay, right. So shall we begin, everyone? So we are going to solve 20 questions of analogies in this session. Let's begin. So here are the first three questions that we have today. Okay, take a look at the first one. So we have goose and gander, and these are the four options: vixen, fox, male, female, dog, puppy, plants and botany. Which one do you think is the correct answer? Quickly type in, everyone. This is quite a simple question. So we are beginning with simple questions and then we will move on to some more complicated questions. All right, let me tell you the correct answer for this one is the first option. So goose is a female bird and gander is a male bird. Okay, that's the relationship that we are looking for. So vixen and fox has the same relationship. So vixen is basically a word for a female fox. Okay, now if you take a look at the second option, male and female, sort of what we are looking for, but the sequence is not right. Okay, we wanted female first and male later. So that is why this option is not correct. Then dog and puppy, you know, again, not correct. We're not looking for this. And plants and botany, how are these two related? Botany is the study of plants. Okay, so then again, this is not related to the words that we have at all. Okay, let's go ahead. Take a look at the next set of words. So slander and glorify. People who attended yesterday's session will remember we've done this word, everyone, slander. Do you remember what the meaning is? Okay, let me tell you the meaning of this one. So slander basically means defame. Okay. So when you say something bad about somebody or when you write something bad about somebody, that can ruin their reputation. That is slander. And glorify is praise. Right? To praise somebody. So what is the relationship in these two words? They are antonyms. All right. So we are looking for antonyms. Now take a look at these words. So the first one, let me tell you the meanings, everyone, so that you can tell me the answer very quickly. Okay, deceit basically is to cheat. You know, if I have to give you the simplest meaning, it is cheat. So basically, deceit is when you hide the truth for somebody for a selfish reason. Okay, so that is deceit. It's a noun and the verb is deceive. Okay, so for example, I can say that I started a business with my friend, but my friend deceived me and I lost all my money that I had put in. Okay, so deceived, lied to me, you know, kept the truth hidden. That is the meaning. Okay, the next one, criticize and praise. Now, criticize is to find faults with something and praise, you know, to say nice things about somebody. Okay, deceit and peace, if you look at these words, they are not really related. Criticize and praise, we can say that these are antonyms. Okay, now pure and chaste, these are synonyms, everyone. Okay, so chaste also means pure. And fish and shoal, does anybody know this word, shoal? So it's a group of fish, okay? A lot of fish swimming together is also called a shoal. So again, not really related to the relationship that we are looking for. So the correct answer here is the second one. All right, let's go to the next one. Okay, so distance and nautical mile. Does anybody know where do we use this nautical mile? So, you know, when you want to measure distance at sea, okay, the measure for that is nautical mile. The unit that is used when you want to measure distance at sea or sometimes air also, it's nautical mile. Now take a look at the words. The first one is love and affinity. So you will realize again, affinity is a word that we have discussed. Affinity is basically the feeling of like, okay. You can say love, you know, fondness. So these are synonyms. Then meter and length. Okay, so this is sort of what we are looking for because meter is a unit to measure length. But then check, see, now we've found a relationship that we're looking for, okay. So now we need to check whether the sequence is right. So here, what do we have first? We have the category first and the unit later. Okay, but if you look here, we have the unit first and the category later. So this is not going to be the answer because the sequence is not right. All right. Then if you look at the third one, we have weight and gram. Now again, you know, okay, weight can be measured in grams. So this is our correct option. And then the last one is light and brightness. Brightness is not the unit to measure light. Okay. So that's why this is not correct. So the correct option is C. All right. Let's go to the next one. Take a look at the words that are given, everyone. So the first word that we have here is periodontist and gums. So periodontist is basically somebody who specializes treats diseases related to gums. Okay, so you can say all of us know a dentist. So a periodontist is a specialization. A person who specifically deals with or treats, cures diseases related to gums. Okay. Now the second word that we have is ophthalmologist. So what does an ophthalmologist treat? So this is that relationship, you know, a worker and, you know, what does he do? His job, what is his specialization? So I think most of you must have figured it out. So an ophthalmologist treats your eyes. So this is the correct answer. Okay, now let's take a look at the next word. It is cat, feline, horse. Now what is the word that we can use to describe a horse? Let's figure out what is the relationship here. So feline is a word which is basically used to talk about the cat family or something that is related to the cat family. Okay, so for example, you can say feline features, you know, something, you know, features which are very distinct to the feline family, you know, features like cat. Okay, now let's go through the meanings, go through the options. I think one word that you will immediately recognize is this one, serpentine. Must have heard of this word serpent. Serpent is a snake. So serpentine is something that is like a snake or related to a snake, let's say. Okay. Canine is used for dogs. So related to the dog family. So you can say a canine disease, a canine problem, habit. Okay. Lupine. Now this word has two meanings. It also means sort of a plant or a flower. And lupine is something that is related to a wolf. Okay. And so the word that we are looking for is equine. Equine is related to the horse family. Okay. So this is the correct answer. Right. Now take a look at the sixth question. This is very simple. Anklet and foot. And then we need to figure out the next pair of words. So anklet, of course, is a piece of jewelry that we wear in our foot. Okay. So we have the jewelry and then we have the place where we wear it. Okay. Now take a look at these options, everyone. The first one is there. It says tiara and head. I think all of you know what a tiara is. Otherwise, I'll just, you know, quickly draw it. Something that princesses wear on their head or queens wear. Something that looks like this. So pardon my drawing, everyone. It's not very good. But, you know, you must have seen, if you've seen pictures of princesses or movies that feature the royal family, they have these beautiful tiaras on their head. Okay, so tiara is something that you wear on your head. So I think we've already figured out what we're looking for. But we'll just go through the next options. So neck and jewelry. Now again, something which is very close because we have, you know, jewelry and we have, you know, the place where we wear that jewelry. But again, take a look at it, everyone. The sequence is not what we want. Okay, so we wanted this first and this later. So that is why this is not the correct option. Then we have watch and accessory. So watch is an accessory. So again, not related to the relationship that we have. And the last one is frame and painting. So frame is where you feature a painting. So again, not really what we want. All right. Okay, so these were some simple questions that we dealt with, mainly to make you understand how to solve questions related to analogies, okay? How to identify a relationship. So, you know, if you go step by step, everyone, you won't be confused, one, and you'll be able to figure out the answer very fast. So, as I said, first step, identify the relationship, okay? The two words that are given to you, identify how they are related, okay? Same meaning, different meaning, a different part of speech, or a worker and his workplace, worker and his tool, or gender. Okay, so that is going to be the first step, identifying the relationship. And then the second one is remembering the sequence. Okay, the relationship that you have figured out, we are looking for the same relationship in the same sequence. That is absolutely necessary. All right, so let's start. Look at the seventh one. Okay, piquant and bland. I'll tell you the meanings of these words and then you can take a look at the options that we have. So piquant is something that is spicy, or you can also say something that is interesting. So it's a word that you can use to describe the taste of something. So you can say, you know, I'll give you a very simple example. So the chutney that we make for pani puri, or, you know, the chaat for chaat, that chutney is quite spicy. So pleasant, spicy, but something that is very pleasant, tasty. Okay. Or you can also say a piquant instance, or, you know, incident. So something that is interesting. Okay. Now bland is something which is dull. Specifically used to describe food. So when you say that a food, you know, a particular dish is bland, you mean that it is sort of tasteless, okay, very mildly spiced. All right. So something that we are saying, something that is interesting, spicy, and the other word is something that is dull. So you must have figured out that the relationship that we have here is antonyms. So we are looking for antonyms in the options, okay? So take a look at the options now. The first one is ambrosial. Okay, the first pair, ambrosial and exquisite. Does anybody know the meanings here? Quickly type in everyone if anybody knows the meanings. All right, so ambrosial is something which is of a very good quality, especially, you know, used for food or smell, which is extremely pleasant. So you can use it for, you know, sweets. You can use it for special dishes that you prepare. So again, giving a very familiar example, I can say my mother prepared some laddus yesterday and those laddus were absolutely ambrosial. So they were excellent in taste. Okay. And exquisite is something that is special, okay, beautiful, something which is not very common. So, you know, you must have realized, everyone, that specifically when we describe certain things, we keep using the same word. So we keep using amazing and awesome. So if you really like something and if you really feel that something is special and it is beautiful, then you can also use this word to describe it. And exquisite can be used to talk about, you know, for example, scenery. You can use it to talk about the taste of some dish. You know, so if you go to a particular place, then you can say it was exquisite. Maybe a piece of clothing. So anything which is absolutely beautiful. So these two words are quite synonymous, okay? Something that is of a very good quality, that is what these words mean. Now, if you look at these two words, so novice is somebody who is inexperienced. Okay, somebody who has not worked a lot before. So I can say, you know, this is a new project and this is a very important project. So I don't want to give it to somebody who is a novice, okay, who is absolutely new. And the second one, neophyte, is also a synonym. This also means somebody who does not have a lot of experience. So again, we have a pair of synonyms here. Now this one, I think all of you, most of you know this word, arid. Arid is something which is absolutely dry. Okay, you can use it to describe a place which has absolutely no or very little rainfall. So, you know, when you talk about a desert, it could be arid. And fertile, you know, where you can grow a lot of things. So these are antonyms. Okay, and let's take a look at the last pair that we have. So we have phenomenal and phenomenal. So only this is the difference, everyone. So basically what we have is, this is the noun, this is the adjective, the same meaning. When you talk about a phenomenon, you mean something that exists and, you know, something that is kind of special. So, for example, recently there was this news of this cyclone called Nisarga. So it is a rare phenomenon. It doesn't happen very frequently. All right. Okay. Let's go to the 8th question that we have for today. Right. So we have tremor and quiver. Any idea? Do you know the meanings? So both these words mean shake, to shake. Okay. So again, to give you a very brief meaning. So tremor is basically to shake. You can use it to talk about somebody's body movement. You can also use it to talk about an earthquake. You know, when you say we felt tremors, you know, it was shaking. And quiver also means to shake rapidly. Another word which is similar is tremble. Okay. So specifically when you are sometimes too excited or too scared of something, you quiver. Okay. So, yeah. So basically what we have here is we have a pair of synonyms. That is the original relationship. Okay. Now see, you must have figured out, everyone, when you have a pair of synonyms or antonyms, you don't really need to notice the sequence a lot because ultimately it's the same thing. okay? But in case if you have a relationship which says a worker and tool, worker and workplace, you know, gender male, female or female male. So in those cases, you'll have to be very careful of the sequence. Okay. Now let's take a look at the options. So scrumptious and delectable. Both these words are synonyms and they mean tasty. Okay. Again, a very nice alternative if you just want to compliment food. Rather than saying something is tasty or yummy, you can say, you know, this was scrumptious. The pav bhaji that my mother made yesterday was scrumptious or it was delectable. Very nice, very tasty. Okay. Unpalatable is something which is tasteless, something that you cannot eat. Okay. Bad in taste. And delicious is tasty. So this is a pair of antonyms. Then terse and polite. I hope you remember this word. We've talked about this word before. So terse means rude, and specifically when, you know, your responses are short and rude. Okay. So that is called terse. And polite, all of you know. So this again is a pair of antonyms, everyone. And the last one is feign and sincere. So feign is to pretend. Okay. To pretend something. So for example, my colleague feigned, illness because he did not want to present, in the meeting today. So he pretended to be sick. So feign and sincere is again a pair of antonyms. Got it? So as we discussed, we were looking for synonyms. So this is the correct answer, right? Okay. Now let's go ahead. Birds and ornithology. Nobody is answering today. Okay. Hello, everyone. I just saw your messages. Amit, Nicole, Jaggu, hi, everyone. So, Amit, today I have, as per your suggestion, I've increased the font. I hope it is clearly visible now. All right. So, let's go ahead with the ninth question that we have. So, birds and ornithology, do you know how these words are related? Can you guess? So, ornithology is the study of birds, okay? In ornithology, you study birds basically. So, that's the relationship that we are looking for. Now, check the words. See if there are any familiar words that you have. Okay, so insects and etymology, sorry, everyone. So insects and etymology is the first option that we have. And the word is quite close, actually. Etymology, you might have heard of this word before. It's basically the study of words. Okay, the history and meanings of words, different words. That study is called etymology. And the study of insects, it's called entomology. Okay, so this is incorrect. Then the next one that we have is fruits and carpology. So carpology is the study of fruits. Study of bird, Nicole is saying. That's absolutely correct, Nicole. Great. So carpology is the study of fruits. Okay, so this is, it is in, we can think of this option. The next one is plants and helminthology. So helminthology is the study of worms, parasitic worms. Okay, so this option is incorrect. And the last one that we have is teacher and pedagogy. So pedagogy basically is the science or method of teaching. Okay, so it is related to teachers. So for example, all teachers study pedagogy. They follow the rules of pedagogy. But it is not, pedagogy is not the study of teachers. Okay. So that is why this option is out. So the correct option is going to be option B. All right. Let's go ahead. Look at the 10th one. So the relationship that we have is necromancy. and dead. Does anybody know what the relationship is? So basically, I'll tell you, necromancy is, let's say, the science or the practice of communicating with the dead. So could be, you know, a lot of forms. I would say the easiest way to remember this word, I don't know if you guys have heard of this, but when you have things like, you know, this planchet and everything, so that could be a form of necromancy when you try to communicate with the dead. Okay. Okay. Nicole is asking, what is horticulture? Right, Nicole? Horticulture is basically the art of maintaining a garden, or, you know, like studying, planning a garden. So more related to a garden. Okay. Right. So we were talking about the 10th one. Necromancy, as I said, is the practice of communicating with the dead. The first one, theft and accomplice. Does anybody know what accomplice means? I'll give you a sentence, okay? Let's see if you can guess the meaning with the sentence. So if you have watched the movie Bunty and Bubbly, all of you know the movie, right? It had Rani Mukherjee and Abhishek Bachchan in it. So they are accomplices of each other. So what could the word mean? I'm saying in Bunty and Bubbly, the characters Bunty and Bubbly are accomplices of each other. So basically, a person who commits another person, who helps another person commit a crime. Okay, so that is an accomplice. And theft is a type of crime, as you know. So essentially, these words are not related. Okay, the next one that we have is culinary and food. So culinary arts is basically where the art of making food, or where you study food. Okay, so these are related. Then we have constancy and temporary. So constancy, something basically, you must have figured out the adjective constant, something that is stable, okay, and temporary. So this is a pair of antonyms that we have. And instinct and intuition. Instinct basically is, you know, like gut feeling. Basically, instinct can also mean the way people, like human beings or animals, behave naturally. So how we say that, you know, to jump, for example, or to wag their tail in happiness is a natural instinct of a dog. Or even when you go, you know, outside and stray dogs try to, they don't let other dogs in their area. So that's their natural instinct of survival. Okay, natural way of behavior. Okay, and intuition is when you take a decision or based on your feelings rather than facts. Okay, so if I have to give you an example, I can say, you know, I had a very nice business proposal from one of my friends, but I decided not to go ahead with it because my intuition told me there was something not right about it. Okay, so that means a sort of gut feeling, or, you know, just the feeling. So did I have any facts that told me that the business proposal was not right? Not really. Okay, but just the feeling that I had that something about it is wrong. So that is intuition. So these two words are actually quite synonymous, instinct and intuition. So the correct answer here is culinary and food. Okay. All right. So let's go to the next one. The 11th one, avarice and generosity. What I'll do, everyone, is I will tell you the meanings of these words, and then you tell me what the answer should be. Okay. So avarice basically is greed, extreme greed for money, for material things. And generosity, as all of you know, kindness. Okay, kindness, or somebody who helps people, who is willing to give people food, give people money. So these two words are quite antonymous. They have opposite meanings. Okay, now take a look at these words and tell me if you can figure out the answer. Nicole, Amit, who else is there? Nicole is there, Amit is there, Jaggu is there. Amit is saying D. Okay, not really, Amit. I'll tell you the words, but not really D. Okay, I'll tell you the meanings, everyone. So to scribble something is to write something very fast. Okay, so for example, when you listen to a lecture, you scribble down notes. So write something very fast and in a sort of careless way. So your handwriting is not nice and everything. And illegible is something that you can't read. So if I say your handwriting is illegible, that means it can't be read. Okay, impossible to read. So these two words are synonyms. Basically, again, I would like to remind you, we are looking for antonyms. Okay, let's take a look at these two words. So to disembark basically means to leave a ship or a plane or something like that. So basically, usually people disembark when their journey is complete. Okay, so to get off, to get down. So that is the meaning. And set off is to start a journey. Amit, I'll answer both those, okay? Apprise and appraise. I'll answer both those. Just let me explain these two options. Okay, so here we are talking about, you know, disembark is often to end a journey. Setting off is often to start a journey. So this can be a contender of the right answer. Okay, then we have brisk and brief. So brisk also means something that is quite short. Okay, and brief also means concise or short. So again, we have a pair of synonyms. And the last one, appease and apprise. So let me first tell you these two words and then I'll answer Amit's question. Okay, so appease is basically to pacify somebody by agreeing to their demands. Okay, to calm somebody down by agreeing to their demands. I'll use it in an example, in a sentence. So, you know, workers of a particular company went on strike because they wanted a pay rise. Okay, so the company appeased them by giving them a bonus. So the company pacified them. The company calmed them down by agreeing to their demands. That is the meaning of appease. And apprise is to inform. Okay, so for example, I can say, so yeah, what is written is apprise, Amit. That is the word. Appraise, what you are talking about, is a different word. So that's what I was saying, that I'll tell you the meaning of this word as well. Okay, so what is written is apprise. So apprise is to inform. So for example, I can say that, you know, nobody apprised me about the promotion that I was about to get. So nobody informed me about it. And what the question that Amit has raised is, appraise is to evaluate. So like you have a performance appraisal, okay, that way. All right, let's go to the next word. Yeah, so the first word that we have here is cajole. Cajole and dissuade. This, by the way, is not cajole. It is cajole. So cajole is to persuade somebody. Okay, to make somebody do something by saying nice words. You know, when you want your work to be done, you praise some people. You say, okay, you're so kind and you're so nice. Please do something for me. So that is cajoling. And dissuade is to discourage something, discourage somebody to do something. Okay, so again, what we have is a pair of antonyms here. Now take a look at the options and tell me which would be the correct answer. So chide is to scold, okay? To scold somebody. So for example, my father chided me for not wearing a mask outside. Scold. And disapprove, again, when you do not like something. So not exactly the same, but you can say sort of similar, okay? Then abet is to assist in wrongdoing. Assist or help somebody to do something wrong. So to give you a sentence, we can say not just the criminal, but also the person who abets him in committing the crime is equally responsible. So assist in wrongdoing. Okay. And deter is to discourage somebody to do something. So Amit, so far this is the fifth session of vocabulary. So far we've had four sessions of vocabulary. Okay. And you'll be able to see all those videos on this channel. So you just need to go to the channel and look for my videos. You'll see all of them there. Okay. So don't worry about that. Also, Amit is saying this one is C. So no, this is not C. I'll just explain. So grit means courage. Okay. So these are synonyms, everyone. Okay. So for example, we say that we salute our soldiers for their grit, for their courage. Okay. And the last one, coarse and rough, these are also synonyms. Okay. So coarse is something that is rough, that is not absolutely smooth. So the correct answer is B, because abet is to help somebody do something and deter is to discourage somebody, dissuade somebody from doing something. Okay. Sure, Amit. You know, so I have a plan for some more sessions. Like, see, we've talked about synonyms, antonyms. Now this is a session of analogies. We've also talked about idioms and words that people get often confused with. Now what is remaining is we are going to talk about root words, because as all of you know, that is very important. It will help you a lot improve your vocabulary. So root words and words that have come from foreign languages. Okay. And after that, once we are done with, one or two more sessions, then we will definitely have a quiz of vocabulary. Okay. And don't worry about it. I will announce it in advance. So we'll decide and then we will, we'll study the words and then we'll play nice games about vocabulary related to vocabulary. Okay. So please watch these, the first session, so that you're ready for the quiz. Now, Amit is saying that he thought that it is abate. Abate is something that we talked about yesterday, Amit. And this word means to reduce in intensity. Okay, to decrease in intensity. So, abet and abate, these two words are quite close to each other. And I'm glad that you remember this word. Very good. Okay, but the meaning is quite different. So, remember the meaning as well. All right. Now, take a look at the next pair, everyone. Complacent and complacency. This is a very easy one. So quickly tell me what the answer should be. Quite easy. Sorry, this should be the answer. I'm sorry, everyone. So this is the correct sequence. Okay. So complacent is the adjective and complacency is the noun. So this is how it should be. Okay. Not noun and verb. Okay. It is so complacent. So complacent is basically when you are satisfied with yourself. Okay. And how do you use it? It actually, we often say that, when you're learning something, you should never be complacent, because when you get complacent, when you are satisfied with yourself, your learning stops. Okay. Or these days when it is about, keeping yourself safe, or, when it comes to health safety, you should never be complacent. You should take utmost care. That is how we use it in a sentence. Okay. So it's an adjective and noun. Okay. Let's go ahead. So polyglot and languages, what's the relationship? A polyglot is a person who knows many languages, okay, who can speak or who can use a lot of languages. So for that person, the answer is polyglot. Amit, are you saying B for 15? So I'll tell you the correct answer is A. Okay. So polyglot is somebody who knows many languages. So similarly, when we talk about a connoisseur is a person who has a great taste in art or food. Okay. So when you say a connoisseur of music, a person who has a really good taste in music, or a connoisseur of food. Okay. It means somebody who understands food well. Okay. Knows like good food. All right. Now traveler and car. No, complacency is not help in wrongdoing. Complacency is being self-satisfied. Abet is help in wrongdoing. Yeah, yes, Amit. Okay, I'll just explain these options and then we'll talk about what your doubt is, Amit. So, we are saying connoisseur is somebody who understands good art, good food, okay? Traveler and car, so these words are related, but we don't use the word traveler for a person who understands cars, essentially, okay? So, this is not the correct answer. Then we have a despot and regime. So, a despot is a ruler who has absolute power, like a dictator. Okay? So basically, a despot has his or own, you know, regime and absolute power. Okay. And then the last one, epidemiologist, is a person who studies diseases, the spread and history of diseases, not animals. So again, this is not correct. So the correct answer is A. Amit, I'll just clarify your doubt. So basically, complacent or complacency is used when you are talking about being satisfied with yourself. Okay. Yeah. And abet is help somebody in committing a crime or help somebody in doing something wrong. That is how these words are used. Yeah. So complacent, let me know, Amit. Even I will check. Okay. So in tomorrow's session, we can just have a quick discussion about this complacent and abet, and we'll confirm this. All right. Now take a look at the next one. So pavement and sidewalk. So these words will, you would think of them as perhaps similar words, which are similar. There's a very sort of small difference. That is, pavement is a word that is used in British English, and sidewalk is a word that is used in American English. Okay, I think all of you know what a pavement is. So when you are on a road, you know the side of the road that you can walk on, which is for pedestrians, that part is called a pavement. So the only difference is in British English they call it a pavement, in American English they call it a sidewalk. So that's how these words are related. Okay, now if you talk about jibe and ridicule, these are again synonymous. To jibe means to mock somebody or insult somebody. So synonymous, but not the relationship that we are looking for, Amit. Okay. Vice and virtue. So vice is a bad quality. Virtue is a good quality. To give you a very simple example, when we talk about lying or envy, okay, jealousy, that's a vice. Okay. And when we talk about honesty, it's a virtue. It's a good quality. Now, the correct answer is this one, jumper and sweater. So, jumper is the word which is used in British English. Even sweater is used in British English, but often sweater is common in American English also. Okay, so this is the relationship that we are looking for. And then these are again antonyms. Lustrous is something that is shiny. Luster is shine, okay, glossy. And dull, as you know, something which is not very bright. Okay. Yes, Nicole has answered correctly. Great, Nicole. Thank you. Let's go to the next one that we have. So, lizard, reptile, and guinea pig. Do you know what a guinea pig looks like? So, a lizard is a reptile. That's the type of animal. A guinea pig is, you know, it looks like a mouse, you can say. A combination of a mouse and a bunny, you can say. It's very cute. And these days, people also have guinea pigs as their pets. So, The correct answer is it's a rodent. Okay. Mammal as well. You can also use the word mammal, but we have a better option. Okay. Mammal is often used for words like 17th. Skip. Why? We didn't skip it. Okay. So, Amit, we are doing the 17th question. We are not skipping it. Okay. All right. So, mammal is often used for animals like cows, dogs. Okay. Even humans. Crustacean is, if you have had these things, crabs. Okay. So, lobsters, crabs. So, these are called crustaceans. Basically, a part of, for us, seafood. Okay. So, those animals are called crustaceans, and insects is something that all of you know. Right. Let's take a look at the next one. Altruism. Altruism is basically selflessness. Okay. So if you want to help somebody, or if you help somebody beyond a selfish interest, you know, without thinking about yourself, you are an altruistic person. Okay. So the social workers that we have, they are altruistic often. Okay. So altruism is a noun. That is the relationship. Now take a look at the options. Okay, Amit, I got it. Thank you. You will not attempt 17th in question. Okay, no problem. Yeah, so altruism is a noun. So what we are looking for is the word and the part of the speech. That's the sequence that we need to keep in mind. Okay, so this one is, you know, correct. So beside is a preposition, but again, if you remember, I had told you the sequence is not correct. Okay, beside should be here, preposition should be next, but then that's why this answer option we can't consider. Then short and adverb. Tell me if this is correct, everyone. Can we use short as an adverb, or is it an adjective? Let's take a look at the next options also. So simmer, adjective. So simmer is not an adjective, it's a verb. Okay, so simmer is basically to boil something. You know, for example, when you're boiling your dal, or when you're boiling your kadhi, and you know, when it starts to form bubbles, you can say it is simmering. Or we need to boil the dal until it simmers, it starts forming bubbles. Okay, so it's a verb, so this is not correct. And sail is a noun, it is not a verb, so this is also not correct. The correct option is this one. C is not correct. Simmer is a verb, it is used as a verb. All right, now short as an adverb can be used, it is also an adjective, everyone. But for example, when you say that, you know, I don't have enough time, so I will have to cut this session short, so in that case we will also use, yeah, so we can also use short as an adverb. Yeah, so Amit, the correct answer is B. Okay, hope everybody has got it. All right, the last two questions that we are going to have for this session, and these are going to be easy. So eat and gobble, bargain, we're looking for the next word. Tell me the answer quickly for 19, everyone. So hassle is a trouble or a difficulty. So for example, when you say, you know, when you're moving into a new house, when you're trying to shift your, you know, things, it's a great hassle. You have to work a lot. It's quite, you know, a difficult thing to do. So that's a difficulty. Discount is something that you ask for. Haggle is synonymous with bargain. And brittle, you know, brittle is also kind of a sweet. So you can say a peanut brittle. And it is also used for something which is hard but delicate. something which is hard but it can be broken easily. So for example, when you become old, your bones become brittle. So they are hard of course, but they can be broken easily. Okay, right. So that's why the correct answer here is going to be C, haggle. And we will now do the last question, continent, country. So what is the relationship? A country is found in a continent, it's a part of a continent, right? Now take a look at the options and tell me quickly. Last question, everyone. I want answers from you very quickly. Is C. That's absolutely correct, Amit. Very well done. A boot is also a part of a car. That's correct. See, even this option is close because clock, you know, the outer part of a clock is called a case, but then the sequence is not right. Okay. So, utensil and spatula. Spatula is a utensil, so this is not something that we want. Again, Earth is a planet, not something that we want. So, the correct option is C. Well done, everyone. So, we are done with this session. Please revise the words that we've done. And Amit, for tomorrow's session, we will also quickly discuss this complacency thing and a bit. Okay. So, I'll see you tomorrow, same time, everyone, at 6 p.m. Okay. We are going to have a couple of more vocabulary sessions and then we'll move on to the next sort of module. All right. Now, please take up the Unacademy Plus subscription to keep learning. On which you will also get to solve a lot of mock tests. So that will give you a lot of practice. You will get to see the leaderboard. So you will get to see the people who are answering questions correctly. And you will get a chance to interact with your faculty more and a lot more facilities. Okay. To subscribe, you just need to download the app on your phone, install it, go to the plus option, select your course, and then start learning on the app. Okay. So the 1 year plan is at 15,750, the 2 year plan is at 18,900 rupees. And if you use this code, which is Apoorva, you will get a 10% off. So please subscribe to Unacademy and do not forget to use this code, everyone. If any of your family members or friends are preparing for any of these exams, please ask them to check out the courses on Unacademy. These are very popular courses. And do not forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel, Unacademy CAT for MBA. Please press the bell icon so that whenever I am going to have another session, whenever a video comes out where, you know, where I am teaching or any other faculty is teaching, you will immediately get a notification. Please follow us on Telegram as well so that you will get the material that is there done in these sessions. Right. Thank you, everyone. Bye for now and see you tomorrow.